Hello and welcome back to Blaze Capital. My name is Justin, and today we have an exciting CEO interview for an up-and-coming gaming company. Hey, Jason, how are you?
I'm very well, thank you. Thank you for your time.
I was quite excited as we went through your company presentation last week on our public video, just because people recognize the characters from your games instantly. They already knew, seen that, I know that. I'm talking specifically about the in-gameplay apps characters you guys have created. So my first question for you is, what are some of the trends you've noticed in the last 2 years, and how is what you built ready for this new recent pivot we're seeing in the gaming industry?
Okay, I think the main trends over the last few years is really change in regulation. So I've actually been in this industry, the gaming industry, since the mid-2000s. I built the world's biggest gambling affiliate. I built gambling.com into America's biggest gaming site. We were selling players to other gaming groups. So I've been in this space for a long time. As you may be aware, the UK has had regulated gambling for over 100 years. So that's why a lot of the companies, a lot of the individuals come from the UK. So the big change for me was that we had to go out of that business because of the change in regulation. And I really wanted to come back into the market. And we saw that the regulation was coming to the US. We love the US market. We see there's a huge opportunity. So I raised a bunch of money. I've got a pretty decent track record in public companies in the US. I built some very sort of scaled, successful businesses. Previously, we raised a lot of money, and we spent a bunch of money and time building our platform to make sure that when the market then changed and the regulation came in, we would have a solution that we could bring into the casinos, the land-based casinos, to enable them to actually build a branded online gaming presence on our cloud-based platform quickly and efficiently. So we spent a bunch of time, a bunch of money to build the platform, and that's where we are now. So that's a really big change as regulations come in.
So it sounds like this is not your first rodeo. And for a company that is headquartered in Las Vegas, something that I noticed even before the lockdown happened is that M&A was quite hot. We saw that Caesars got acquired and there was a lot of buzz. People are always very excited about that. So what are some of the trends you're kind of noticing happening? And another question I kind of have is, how long did it actually take to develop those in-game characters? Because I'm assuming that didn't probably happen overnight.
Well, we obviously develop games. We also basically buy in third-party games. So we make sure that in each market, we have the best possible games content, which is critical. Obviously, trying to create a game which is successful is really hard work. You find often, it's like 1 in 10 maybe work a lot certainly don't. So, it's a lot of development. I mean, actually, the player account management system that we built, which is literally best in class, it's cloud-based, it's super efficient. The cost of actually adding another player to our platform is almost negligible. So it all comes down to can you acquire players quickly and efficiently, which is quite key. But we spent nearly 3 years building our platform, millions of man hours. So wow. Yeah, you're right, it takes time.
And 3 years, so that means that you were bullish on online gambling before it was popular. And I think it's pretty safe to say that the foundation that you've laid to get us here is part of the reason why you guys are looking to go to the public markets now. And I really respect that, because people are usually early. They don't really usually have a strong stance. And with your background, with your experience, I think that's a winning combination. So the second thing that really stood out to me as we were going through and looking through your deck was Playboy. What I notice is that everybody knows Playboy, but what are they doing lately? That's what everyone's kind of wondering. Like, okay, I recognize the brand and I know they got some cachet, but how can a former iconic company like Playboy return to grace? And how are you helping them get there?
Okay, so I think Playboy is new and invigorated. It's obviously an iconic US brand, but it went public relatively recently in the US. So they've changed their whole strategy away from licensing to being more direct to consumer. So we've signed an exclusive deal with them for a number of markets, specifically India initially, which is a huge market, 1.6 billion people who love to gamble. Playboy is incredibly well recognized in that market. So it was a great opportunity for us. And, obviously they choose their partners very, very carefully. We have a great track record in building out the software and games and actually, we get very good at what we do. So they trust us to go and build the software, build the games, to actually also invest to acquire the players and actually to actually manage the player experience. So, I mean, our business model is slightly different to a lot of our competitors because we can do all aspects of player acquisition, retention, and so on. So I think they trust us to do a good job and to maintain their iconic brand.
Mm-hmm. And it's really interesting because, again, companies don't give an exclusive agreement to anybody willy-nilly. I think that if we can read between the lines here, it kind of means that they've done their due diligence. They understand that if we're going to work with a partner, we kind of want the best. So that's really nice to hear. Another question I have is in terms of licenses. So we've been noticing that licenses have a particular value for this sector. So what is your unique approach when it comes to licenses and what do they mean for you?
Yeah, so we focus very much on regulated markets. So we don't, you know, there's a lot of chat if you look at SB Tech that's part of DraftKings in terms of what they call unregulated markets. So in the olden days, you know, if you had a market, a license in Curaçao or some of these markets, you could then try and sell or, you know, market into countries for gaming, gambling. But we're seeing people are moving away from that global approach to a local approach. Governments and states in the US are now saying, actually, enough of that. We want the tax dollars. We want to put in a framework which not only, you know, it also protects people as well, because it means, you know, that you can put in frameworks to make sure that there's best practice in how you deal with responsible gambling and so on. So, yeah, so we're very much focused on regulated markets. And we either try and work, we mostly try and work with local partners, which typically are the land-based casinos, which then give us access deals to get us into a market. So, for example, in Mexico, which is a huge market, 160 million people, it's regulated. We've secured one of only 14 licenses with our land-based casino partner, Big Bola. They have 22 casinos in Mexico. And we've created a new brand called Vale, which is pretty exciting. We're rolling out across Latin America at the moment. We signed up over 100,000 players in a matter of months because we have a lot of experience in player acquisition and our games and products super, super good. So yeah, we're trying to get more access deals in really good markets where we believe we can make really good money and scale this business really quickly.
So what I'm hearing is that you guys kind of have your fingers in quite a few different things in the sector. So we've heard about a company like Playboy, big brick and mortar companies like the one in Mexico, celebrity sponsorships. So maybe you could explain to us, what's your business model?
Okay, so the business model really it's all about scaling quickly. So you know we spent a bunch of money to build this best in class platform. The platform deals with all aspects of everything you possibly need to run an online gambling business. So everything from retention with the AI tools to onboarding of players, you know, withdrawals, managing payments, and so on. So basically, we built that platform, and we just need to just get a lot of people onto our platform because it's basically, as you say, it's a very much it's fixed cost. It runs on AWS, Amazon Web Services. It's cloud-based, it's infinitely scalable. We just need to go and acquire as many players as possible. So we're looking at the easiest way to do that. So Playboy, great brand recognition. It means we can acquire players more cost-effectively in India. In Latin America, we've created a new brand. So to give the brand credibility, we've signed a deal with Canelo. And for example, in Mexico, very famous Mexican boxer who's fighting in Las Vegas, in fact, in November. He's got over 15 million followers on social. So we do, you know, we use that to leverage his existing kind of fan base. And we have an exclusive deal with Canelo, both for sportsbook and for casino, not just for Mexico, but for the whole of Latin America, Central America, and the US, because we think the US is going to be a really interesting market for us, but specifically aiming at the Spanish-speaking community, which I'm sure you're aware is huge. In certain states, it's over 20%. So you know, we see that being a massive opportunity. But by leveraging those kind of relationships gives us huge credibility. And in fact, actually, our cost of player acquisition fell in Mexico when we launched the TV campaign with Canelo's awesome campaign. We had, I think, over 50 million impacts over the weekend of his last fight. And yeah, we saw a significant drop in cost of player acquisition because of using his image and people saying, wow, these guys must be serious. They have Canelo and he's a superstar in Mexico.
So what I keep hearing you say is exclusive. So what I'm hearing is that like for some reason, companies want to keep partnering with you and saying, we want them all to ourselves. That's kind of what it sounds like here. So if I'm reading between the lines, what I hear is that you guys are basically gambling as a service. I've never heard that word before, but as I'm thinking about it, everyone's something as a service. So would it be safe to say you guys are kind of like gambling as a service where you have like a holistic view to the space and you know what, you need this piece, we can package it up for you and give it to you. Is that fair?
Well, that's correct. So basically we have what we call a tech stack, which is basically all the aspects of the system and the integration of which gives a complete solution, technical solution. But what we then layer on top of that, which is unusual, as I mentioned, you know, I built the world's biggest gambling affiliate business in the mid 2000s as a public company. I have my last company as a public company in the UK called FairFX, the Equals Group. We have over a million customers in the UK. It turns over 3 billion a year. It's a big business. So I know how to scale businesses. And, you know, and it's all about, you know, credibility, you know, and having in my mind, you know, what's interesting about this industry is that a lot of the land-based casinos, you started off talking about M&A, the reason that all the land-based casinos are buying all the online guys is because it's a very different skill set. So, you know, our model is really interesting because we can go to a land-based casino and say, do you know what? We can do it all. We can acquire the players. We can sign deals with Canelo. We can invest. Mm-hmm. We've got the best in class tools for retention. And the reason that we want to be a listed company or a listed company in the US is really access to the fuel to enable us to basically fund the acquisition and player acquisition, because mm-hmm. effectively you're buying a future revenue stream, right? So mm-hmm. our players, if in our last filing, which they're spending on average $16 a month with us, so you're building up a long-term annuity revenue stream. Mm-hmm. That's why really the capital markets, I believe, work so well for this type of business, because they understand that you need to invest to build these huge player bases, which generate huge revenues in the future and huge profits.
So celebrity endorsements, I don't think I've really seen too many from other companies as well. So again, I think what this tells me is that you have your unique background where you understand the service, but then also the marketing on top, because it's great to build something, but then you have to have people excited about it. So correct. Maybe you could briefly touch on that. Like, how do you build something and then get people excited about it? How would you guys do that over at GMGT?
Okay, so if you look at, for example, the work we do, we signed a deal with the world's biggest ad agency, creative agency, WPP Group. Mm-hmm. We're one of the first time it's ever happened, right? So we're super ambitious. We're very, very aggressive. And very aggressively trying to build this business. So what do? You go to the best guys. And one thing that's interesting is that if you have a platform that can infinitely scale, and really it's all about how quickly can you acquire players, then actually you need to have to work with the best possible people. So WPP means in every market, in Colombia, in Chile, in Mexico, in India, you know, they have the biggest and best creative agency, creative force in every market. So that gives us that kind of extra edge to make sure that when we hit, you know, for example, we produced a TV advert for Canelo that he loved, right? He just loved the advert, made him look super cool. It was amazing for us. It was amazing for the Valet brand. He heavily promoted on his social. We had over, I think, it was 14 million people watch the TV ad through organic social. Just not paid, wow. just organic, which is phenomenal. We put one of the copies of a separate cut of the ad on YouTube, and it's got over 5 million people watched it. And they watch over 95% of it. So if you create great content, you know, people will, you know, will not only basically sign up to what you do, but also they, you know, it basically drives the cost down of player acquisition, which is what this is all about. So yeah, I have a pretty decent experience and background in acquisition of, you know, direct consumer businesses and actually building those out. And I think that's really what people like Big Bowler have bought into in Mexico, or Playboy bought into, because they understand that we can actually, having a great business that no one knows about is rubbish. You know, you need something that you can really, you know, get players and get revenue and build mm-hmm. these things quickly. It's critical.
So a follow-up question is, what I'm hearing is, like, you guys have probably a fixed overhead because you're mostly like a service company, which means you're online. So how do you guys compare to your peers when it comes to actually scaling? So that's what this business is all about. How can we scale? How do you compare to your competitors?
Well, you know, I built my first big business in the 90s, a big internet service company. I floated in 98, but in fact, we're the first internet service business to float in the European Stock Exchange. So I've gone through kind of highs and lows, ups and downs. So what it's taught me is you've got to be flexible, you've got to be lean. And that's how we run this business. We don't have any, you know, wasted costs. We run development in-house. That's really, really critical. But as you're saying, we have a massive advantage because all our software is brand new. Most of our competitors have huge issues with legacy systems. When you do a lot of M&A, you end up with five or six different platforms, which you have to maintain because you become nervous that if you basically try and switch everyone to one platform, all your players are going to leave because they don't recognize it's different games, it's different content. So we basically built this business from the ground up with the best possible tech, and it gives us a huge advantage. It's all cloud-based, it's AWS. Mm-hmm. If you look at all the businesses that have a history of scaling really effectively, they're all in AWS, they're all cloud-based, and that's where we are. So as you're saying, the cost of adding another player is almost like zero. So therefore, mm-hmm. just how quickly can we grow the business? How quickly can we acquire more players? Well, you know, we have WPP Group in every market to help us basically acquire players, and access to capital markets to help fund that future revenue growth. So yeah, we think we're pretty smart in how we built this business out, and it's, you know, we run it pretty lean, and it gives us a huge competitive advantage.
And like I can only imagine that signing, again, like one of the biggest casinos in Mexico, signing Playboy, you probably have the resources already to scale up further. So I really like what I heard. My final question for you is a very simple one. So now that you've filed uplisted to the NASDAQ, what do you see as the next steps or the future for gaming tech, GMGT?
Okay, I think what we really want to do is we want to build out our network of relationships with licenses. So we've already said in Vale, we're building that out across Latin America, and also looking at some of the southern states, for example, in the US, where there's a big percentage of Spanish speaking community. Obviously corporately, going to we filed the S1 for NASDAQ. Hopefully that will work out quickly. That gives us access to the fuel we need, the capital to really aggressively grow this business. If you know my background and the business I built, mm-hmm. I have a good record in actually scaling companies, and this is all about scale. So the access deals are key. So you're going to see us signing a lot of access deals, a lot of very, very good markets where we can make a really good return, much bigger ROIs than some of the companies are making, for example, in the US at the moment, which is obviously very competitive. Yeah, so I think really more of the same, more access deals, more content deals. So we've got the new version of our platform coming out in the next mm-hmm. 2 weeks. The new platform is just phenomenal. It doesn't really look like a gaming or gambling platform. It's much more inclusive. It's much more mainstream. It looks like a kind of a mashup between kind of Netflix, Apple Arcade, and Amazon Prime. So it's much more mainstream, because we want to work out how do we get to millions of players. And if you look at the casual and hyper casual games market, we have hundreds of millions of players playing Candy Crush and so on. There's not much difference between some of the games that we have and those games. Okay, the way we monetize them is different, but fundamentally they're mm-hmm. fun. This is all about people spending $20 a month and having fun, and that's what we're in the business to do. So you'll see some pretty big innovation coming out of the company. I never sit still. We always try to disrupt ourselves, if that makes sense.
And I can hear the excitement in your voice. So it really sounds like there's exciting things happening. I can tell for the size of the company that you have, being a newly issued company, there's a lot to already be excited about. And going through the interview and speaking with you, Jason, I can really hear that you're excited for the future. So I'm really looking forward to that platform update. I know I'll be personally tuning in. And
great.
I wish you all the best of luck in the future here.
I really appreciate your time. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Jason. Take care.